ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः गुकारस्त्वन्धकारो वै रुकारस्तन्निवर्तकः अन्धकारनिरोधित्वात् गुरुरित्यभिधीयते सदाशिवसमारम्भान् शंकराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्ताम् वन्दे गुरुपरम् ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधिताम् भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथिताम् पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्ब त्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी यं ब्रह्मा स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तन्न विदुःसुरा सुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः Let us recite the first verse, page number 5. Shri Bhagavan Vacha Param Bhuyah Pravakshyami Jnananam Jnanamuttamam यज्ञात्वा मुनयः सर्वे परां सिद्धिमितो गताः सो दिस 14th चैप्टर बिगिन्स विथ द स्टेटमेंट बाय द टीचर माय लॉर्ड कृष्णा बिकॉज The discourse of the 13th chapter would have created several questions in the mind of Arjuna. And then Lord Krishna sees it necessary to answer those questions. So sometimes Arjuna asks questions openly and Lord replies them. Sometimes Lord Krishna senses the questions in the mind of Arjuna and replies them. So this is one of those occasions. Because in the 13th chapter, Lord Krishna said, Purusha prakritisthohi bhungte prakritijan gunan karanam gunasangosya sadasad yoni janvasu. Purusha, the person, the self, the consciousness, prakritisthohi. So in 13th chapter itself, Lord Krishna said that what we call I or the ego is made up of these two principles or two entities, Purusha and Prakriti. Here word Purusha means consciousness. Purusha means one who is complete. Purnatvat Purusha. One is whole, one is complete, is called Purusha. Or Purishayanat Purusha, one who dwells in the hearts of all the living beings, the self of all, is also called Purusha. That is the self, that is the consciousness. Prakriti. Yesterday we said how the self, the consciousness, manifests himself as clothed in matter, as the costume of the matter. Just as an actor puts on a costume, such as that of a beggar, and performs the role of a beggar. Actor is not the beggar. Actor himself is a very wealthy person who is chosen to put on the costume of a beggar and plays the role of a beggar. As long as the actor is clear and conscious that I am playing a role, so long it's good because he enjoys that role. Even while effectively acting as a beggar, he is conscious in his own mind that I am an actor, a wealthy person, and therefore just by putting on the costume of beggar, I do not become the beggar, I remain what I am, because the costume really has no connection with the actor at all. To the outside, to the spectators, sometimes actors act so effectively, it looks like very real, and so it is possible that somebody may think that he is a real beggar. But the actor is all the time aware of his identity. Our Swami would say that in the script of an actor, of a beggar, sometimes he weeps out of pain. So this actor is able to bring out real tears from his eyes, effectively acting as a beggar. Within his mind, he congratulates himself, look how effectively I am able to weep or cry. Meaning that there is a distance between the beggar and the actor. The beggar is confined only to the costume. And the actor, because he is aware of his identity, there is a distance. What's the distance? Not distance of time or place, because the time when the beggar is, then the actor is, the place where the beggar is, there the actor is, and still there is a distance between them. What is the distance? That is the distance of knowledge. So the actor enjoys a distance with the beggar by the knowledge or awareness of his true nature. So as long as The actor is aware of his true nature, it is a role. If for some reason the actor forgets his identity, for whatever reason, he becomes identified with the role, then he no more remains an actor, he becomes a beggar. If the actor happens to identify with his costume, with his role, see, normally that does not happen. But today, even as the actor is leaving his home for coming to the studio where the play is going to be acted, he was having a conversation with his wife and became an argument, became heated argument. Both of them were very angry. And this man is getting late for work and therefore he had to leave without completing that argument. He is angry. With all that anger, he comes to the studio. Anger is not yet gone. He puts on his costume as a beggar. And the costume is worn in the green room and he comes to the stage. And before you come to stage, in the green room, there's a big mirror where everybody looks at himself. As to how I look, I'm all right. So this fellow looks at, I'm back, okay, comes to the stage. And the acting is going on. At one point, the beggar is sitting on the roadside, on the sidewalk, has spread his cloth in front of him. People pass by, somebody throws a coin, somebody is more generous, somebody does not even look at him, somebody taunts him, what are you doing, you are a healthy person, why did you go and work, why are you begging, etc. So lots of things happen to a beggar. Sometimes he is insulted also. It's a daily routine, he goes through it, and as a beggar, he is not supposed to react to anything, because he's a beggar. But today, when that fellow insulted him, he just got up and gave him a punch. And the curtains came down. The director came and said, what did you do? Why did you punch him? Why did he insult me? To insult is his role. What is your role? To put up with it. Why did you punch him? When that fellow punched him, he ceased to remain the actor. He became the beggar. Is it not so? He became identified with his role and he became the beggar. In Vedanta, this phenomenon is called identification. And we are not unfamiliar with it. We also sometimes identify. I said yesterday, while watching a movie, watching a favorite actor, you just sympathize, you know, there is a sympathetic reaction. The actor is happy, then the movie, you become happy. If he wins lottery, you also jump with joy. If his wife leaves and he's crying, then you also start crying. Even though your wife may be sitting beside, you start, you know, forget who you are. In identification, a person forgets who the person is and becomes somebody else. If you are a real fan of basketball and watching your warriors and rooting for them and shooting for them and shouting for them, and then the critical time they lost the game just for a little thing, so much disappointed, you start crying. People cry. you see me crying, I don't even know how to hold a basketball really, let alone playing. So identification, I as though forget my identity, become something else, somebody else. So Vedanta teaches that in our life also there is an identification because of ignorance. Identification presupposes ignorance also. Ignorance momentarily, when you momentarily identify with somebody or something, there is ignorance of who you are and there is becoming of who you are not. Identification is possible only when you forget who you are. As long as the actor is conscious of his identity, identification will not happen. But when you become momentarily unaware of your identity, identify. So two elements are involved, ignorance of who you are and superimposition of who you are not. It's called superimposition. You superimpose upon yourself your star basketball player. If he's crying, you also cry. There are some fellows who live in California and still root for Cleveland. There are fellows. He will jump in joy. That's also identification. But there is sympathetic reaction. So in identification, two elements are there. Ignorance of who you are, ignorance of your true nature, and becoming something else, or superimposing something upon you that you are not. So Vedanta teaches, and Lord Krishna also says, that something like this is happening in our life. The 13th chapter, there's a verse which says, Purusha Prakritisthohi. This Purusha, the Paramatma, the Self, the Limitless. Prakriti. Prakriti means the personality, person and personality. The actor and the costume. This Purusha, the Paramatma, the Limitless Self, has put on the costume of matter called Prakriti. Prakriti means primordial matter. That matter alone transforms itself as his body, mind, sense complex. So Vedanta says that not only our gross body is matter, even mind also is matter. The only difference is that the gross body is a product of gross matter and mind is a product of the same matter in its subtle stage. It's matter. As long as this person is aware of his identity, there's no problem. Playing the role, you can enjoy that. Unfortunately, we are born with ignorance of our true nature. And also born with the habit of identifying with our costume, identifying with our body, mind, sense complex. This is how we are born. Born with the wrong GPS. If GPS shows you wrong thing, what will you do? You trust your GPS and then it takes you in altogether a different direction, takes you for a ride. You go round and round and destination is in a different direction and you are wandering in some other place. Similarly also, we are all born with a wrong programming in GPS. In Kathopanishad, it is said, Paranchakhani Vyatma Svambhu Tasmat Parang Pashyati Nantaratman. Ishvara, the Lord, has made the mind of a human being extrovert. Meaning that we are born with this notion that what I am seeking is to be found out there. The happiness that I am seeking is to be found out there. The happiness in life that I want, the peace I want, love I want, success I want, all different names for the same thing is out there. We are born with that programming, you know. Where is that happiness and success? It is yourself. Like the tenth man is searching for the tenth man because of not including himself in the count. Similarly, we are searching for ourselves. Each one of us is searching for success or happiness, fullness, peace, love, which is our own nature. But somehow, because of wrong programming, we have concluded that I am unhappy, I am agitated, I am incomplete, I am inadequate, I am needy, I am dependent, I am helpless. This is what I have concluded about myself. This is the opinion that I am entertaining about myself. Call it opinion, call it conclusion, call it judgment, call it delusion, call it complex, different names. And once this wrong program is there about myself, that I, who in fact is limitless or complete in my nature, I take myself to be a limited being, incomplete being, inadequate being, first wrong programming. And secondly, in the world's its objects and achievements where there is no happiness, because world is not designed to give us happiness. It's not designed. It is designed to give us comfort. It is designed to help us live our life. So we have to live our life. We eat and drink and, you know, fulfill our responsibilities. We have to do all that. And for that, the world is very necessary. But we also want happiness. And there, Ishvara has not created the world as a means of happiness. But somehow, in a wrong programming, we are born with this conclusion that happiness is out there. So whereas happiness is my nature, I take myself unhappy. And whereas happiness is not in the world, I have concluded that that is where the happiness is. We are born with this programming. You follow? With this GPS. And we are guided to live our life. There can never be success because our basic assumption is wrong. I am looking for a given thing where it is not. I can never find it. So this is what Lord Krishna said, Purusha Prakritistho hi Bhungte Prakritijan Gunan. Purusha is in the place of an actor. Prakriti, this body, mind, sense complex, in the place of the costume. Prakritistha is born with identification of the costume. Like an actor identifies with the costume of a beggar and thinks he is a beggar, so also this limitless self identified with the limited costume and believing that he is a limited being. Bhungte prakritijan gunan. And now he becomes a seeker of happiness. The one whose happiness is his nature becomes a seeker of happiness. Like that actor who is a very wealthy person, but on account of taking himself a beggar, becomes a seeker of wealth, you know. See what ignorance does? कारणम गुणसंगोस्य एज अ रिजल्ट ही परफॉर्म्स वैरायटी ऑफ एक्शंस एंड क्रिएट्स फॉर हिमसेल्फ ए सीरीज ऑफ बर्थ एंड डेथ. दिस इज व्हाट लॉर्ड कृष्णा हैज सेड इन द 13th चैप्टर. सो देयर वाज अ वर्ड गुणा. गुणा मीन्स द क्वालिटीज. सो क्वेश्चन इज व्हाट आर दिस गुणास, व्हाट आर दिस क्वालिटीज, व्हाट आर द डिस्पोजिशंस. संग अटैचमेंट टू द माइंड. What's the nature of attachment? What does it do? What kind of bondage it produces? All this was not explained in the 13th chapter. So these questions would have remained in Arjuna's mind. Therefore, Lord Krishna begins the 14th chapter in order to answer these possible questions in the mind of Arjuna. So we can see how not only is this student tuned up with the teacher also is tuned up with the student. The teacher has all the concern for his disciple. As you said, that here is not like a professor coming to the classroom and giving lecture and going away. I mean, I need not say professor is like that, but it's possible. The teacher is something more than that. The teacher has a concern, the guru has a concern for his disciple. Rukaras tvandhakaroi rukaras tannivartaka. That there is the darkness of ignorance in the heart of the disciple, and the guru wants to remove that darkness by the light of knowledge. And therefore, guru does not consider his own task complete unless that happens. So that being the case, Lord Krishna, on his own initiative, imparts the teaching of Arjuna, which Lord Krishna thinks Arjuna needs to know. Before going to that topic of this guna, Lord Krishna, in the first verse that we discussed yesterday, first of all, Lord Krishna praises the knowledge, describes the glories of the knowledge. Param jnanam pravakshami. I will teach you the ultimate knowledge. So this knowledge which Lord Krishna is going to impart is called ultimate knowledge, number one. Jnananam jnanamuttamam. It is the most exalted among all forms of knowledge. Most exalted among all forms of knowledge and the ultimate knowledge, gaining which nothing remains to be gained. Yajnatva munayasarve param siddhimito gataha. Gaining which knowledge many sages have attained the ultimate success, which is what is called moksha or liberation. Meaning that this knowledge is the direct means of moksha or liberation. Liberation from what? Freedom from what? Freedom from unhappiness? Freedom from sadness? Freedom from grief? Understand that the only agenda we have in our life is that we want to become free from grief or sadness. This sadness or grief is a unique problem with human being. Nobody else has this kind of sadness. No other creature has. No dogs and cats have any sadness. Not Indian dogs and cats. Our pets may have some sadness possible, you know. But then the street dogs have no sadness. No grief. No depression. That is not meant to say that we should go back to becoming a dog. That's not the point. This is just to contrast how human being is a miserable creature. The most miserable creature in the whole creation is human being. And that is deliberate. That misery is for the human being to help him. The sadness, grief, misery, unhappiness which he feels, is meant to help him, because then only he'll be motivated to become free from their sadness. Otherwise, so sadness is potentially there in all creatures, but they're not aware of it, so they don't try to become free from that. Human being is aware of it, and thereby struggling, constant struggle is to become free from that sadness, unhappiness. So what is moksha? Freedom from sadness, freedom from unhappiness, freedom from sorrow. That's all, Swami, that's moksha. We thought that moksha means something unusual. Some miracles would happen. I'll start flying in the air. I'll walk 6 inches above the earth. I thought I'll get some unusual powers, and that's called moksha. Suppose you get those unusual powers. Suppose you can fly in the air, you can walk on water, you can read everybody's thoughts, you can do miracles. Suppose you can do. So what? Understand that those miracles also, any of those achievements also cannot make us free from sadness. Understand that. Because in spite of performing any kind of miracles, the fact that I am a limited being, that notion will not go. Even if I am the greatest person on this earth, even then. Because I am, as our Swami would say, I can become mighty but never almighty. I can become big but never limitless. I am not going to satisfy simply by becoming big. My desire is to become limitless. And no miracle, no nothing, no accomplishment on this earth or any other place in the universe can ever make me limitless. So understand that our need is very simple. We need not worry about getting any kind of miracles or any kind of unusual stuff. We don't need that. If it comes on its own, well, we don't need it. Our need is very simple, and that is to become free from a sense of limitation. If limitedness was my nature, I can never become free from limitedness. But Vedanta teaches that one who is limitless takes himself to be limited, and therefore knowledge that you are limitless is the solution of that problem. So we must understand where Vedanta comes from, at what level Vedanta is operating. It's not simply an intellect. Intellectually also it is very, exciting, no doubt. But that will not last too long. Vedanta teaches that the only problem you have is one of ignorance, and ignorance is to be removed. So as I said, on account of ignorance, we are all born with a tendency to identify with what we are not, with our costume, the body, mind, sense complex. And the sense of limitedness that we are feeling is not because we are limited, but because we are identified with our costume, which is limited. And therefore, what is to be done is create a distance with our costume. That's all. Just as that wealthy actor, on account of identifying with his costume, thinks that I'm a beggar. The way for him to become wealthy is not by any action, by recognizing that wealthiness is my nature, by creating a distance, recognizing that costume I am not. So this is what 13th chapter taught us. That's what the 14th chapter also is teaching us. How to recognize non-self as non-self? How to create a distance? And how to know the self in its true nature? Again, before doing that, in the second verse that we have selected, Lord Krishna is telling us about the creation. How does the creation come about? So let us read the second verse and we will tell you how what this verse says is related to what it is that we need to do. So let us read that verse on the page number 8.
Mama yo nirmahat brahma tasmin garbham dadhamyaham sambhavas sarva bhutanam tato bhavati bharata.
So look at the translation. Hey Bharata, hey Arjuna, mama yonihi mahat brahma. Mama means mine, yonihi womb, mahat brahma, mahat, primordial cause, brahma. So, Lord Krishna says that my womb is the source of creation, is called mahat brahma. Vedanta explains that, and we know from our day-to-day experience also that every creation requires a minimum of two things. One is the maker and other is the material. A clock, for example, requires at least two things, a maker of the clock and the material, out of which the different parts of the clock are made and are assembled by the clockmaker. A pot also requires a maker, the pot maker, and the clay or some substance from which the pot is made. So also the whole universe requires these two, the maker and the material. Lord Krishna says, I am the maker and my Maya is the material. Call it Maya, call it Prakriti, call it primordial matter. For Maya, in this verse, Lord Krishna uses the word Mahat Brahma. In unusual sense, word Brahma is used here, understand? So, word Brahma has several meanings. But the derivative meaning is Bruhatvat Brahma. Bruhi vriddhau, that which grows. So something is called Brahma because it grows, it is big. So Maya also in a certain sense can be called Brahma because see, a word has what we call the common meaning and a derivative meaning. So commonly Brahma does not mean Maya. Commonly Brahma means something else. But derivatively, Brahma means that which is big, or that which grows, or that which brings about a growth. Since Maya brings about the growth of the universe, therefore, in a derivative sense, Maya also can be called, the word Brahma can be used for Maya. Another word is Mahat. Mahat means that which is great. Maya is a cause, and cause is always greater than the effect. So, the Maya is the greatest with reference to universe. So, Mahat and Brahma, both these words refer to Maya or primordial matter or the creative power. Let me just talk a little bit about this Maya, something simple to understand, because when Maya comes, you know, we get little excited and we get nervous. So, Maya, I can't understand. Explain to me Maya. So understand that what is the ultimate reality is called Brahman, or the Self, or God, which Vedanta says is Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Brahma. The ultimate reality is Satyam, Truth, Jnanam, Consciousness, Anantam, Limitless. The limitless consciousness, which is the truth, is Brahman, or the ultimate reality, is what we call God. This is Vedanta's God. A second statement says, Ekameva Advitiyam, this Brahman is one without a second, meaning what is this Brahman? What is this consciousness? What is this limitlessness, consciousness, Satyam, truth? That's all there is. But Swamiji, I see a world in front of me. I see myself. I am limited. Everything in the world also is limited. You say that limitless is the only truth. Then what about how to explain this limited world? You say that consciousness is the truth. How to explain the material world? The table is not consciousness. Microwave is not consciousness. They are all insentient things. So if consciousness is the reality of life, how do you explain the insentient? How do you explain the universe? Only we can explain is that consciousness, which is Brahman, which is truth, which is God, appears as this universe of names and forms. The creation is names and forms, which all appear to us like all matter, material. How can matter, which is inert, come out of Brahman, that is consciousness? Vedanta says that Brahman, which is consciousness, appears as the universe of matter. Not much different from what science says. Science says that what we call matter is the waves of energy. They call it energy, right? So this, I guess, everybody knows by now. E equal to mc square, etc. But the thing is that matter and energy are convertible. The energy manifests as matter. Energy is one and manifests as all these multifarious, diverse matter. I guess this much knowledge we have, isn't it? That's what science says. Vedanta goes a step further. Vedanta is not energy, but consciousness manifests as matter. Understand that. Consciousness first manifests as energy, and energy in turn manifests as matter. What is this energy? Similarly, Vedanta, what is this consciousness? And energy is nothing but manifestation of consciousness. And what we call the material world is manifestation of energy. So what is consciousness? Even this table and chair are nothing but what? Consciousness manifesting in this. So matter is very tangible. Energy is not tangible. Intangible manifests as tangible matter. Intangible consciousness manifesting as tangible matter. Why, Swamiji? I don't know. Therefore, they say that consciousness has as though the power to manifest as the tangible material world. Call it power. There is no power, but power. That power is called Maya. Meaning that consciousness, because of its power of Maya, manifests as the tangible universe of names and forms. Because if you really take any name and form, as a scientist may take any piece of matter, and keeps on subdividing and subdividing and subdividing into the, you know, subatomic particles, subdivide, you know what will happen? It will reduce itself to energy. Vedantin says that if you further go, then energy will reduce itself to consciousness. Now, for that the method is different. For reducing matter to energy, scientific science of matter method. But for reducing energy to consciousness, you have to go inside, not outside. That's a different truth. Ultimately, what is energy reveals itself to be nothing but consciousness, and that is you. So Lord Krishna says, I am the consciousness, I am the matter. So mama yo, mama maya, my creative power. I tasmin garbham dadhamyam, I enliven my creative power and the whole universe comes into being. See, the way it is explained, really nothing new is created. Vedanta says, nothing new is created. The whole universe also is not new. It is a cyclic creation. When this cycle of creation will be over, all the whole universe will go to sleep. Whole universe will go to its causal state. You know how the scientists are explaining what is Big Bang? From the cause, the whole universe is expanding. A time will come, it will run out of steam and start contracting and again go back to cause. Vedanta says this has been going on from the time beginning. Cause to effect, effect to cause. Unmanifest to manifest, manifest to unmanifest. So Vedanta says there is no real creation, no real distraction. And therefore, when the dissolution comes, the whole universe goes to causal state. You can say the whole universe goes to sleep. What is creation? When the whole universe will wake up, that's the next cycle of creation. Just as when we go to sleep, we go to our causal state. When we wake up, we come to the manifest state. But the fellow who went to sleep, he alone wakes up, not somebody else. That is, as our Swami used to say, if an idiot goes to sleep, an idiot wakes up. With all our desires, with all our likes and dislikes, with all our memories, same fellow wakes up. Sometimes when we go to sleep, we wish that I don't want to wake up. There is so much stress, so much problem. I wish I have a new person when I wake up. That doesn't happen. Same fellow wakes up with all these problems. Similarly, when we go to sleep at the time of dissolution and we then have a long sleep, but when we wake up, with the same fellows wake up with the same kind of samskaras or ragadveshas, you know, same thing comes back. So really speaking, what we call creation is nothing but waking up those fellows who are sleeping. That's called creation. From sleep to waking. Unmanifest to manifest. So Lord Krishna says, how does creation take place? The combined actions of all the jivas or living beings who are sleeping, all of them now are ready to fructify, and that's how everybody wakes up. You see, when we wake up in the morning also, who wakes us up, you know? Our own karma wakes us up. Even though we may think that it is the alarm clock which has woken us up. But who set the alarm clock in the first place? I did, isn't it? Why did I do? Why should I want to wake up at 5 o'clock? So, I have to go tomorrow to catch a flight. I have to go early. My karma. So, karma wakes up. Similarly, combined karma of all jivas, living beings, wakes up the whole universe. And so, Upanishad say that at the beginning of creation, Lord says, may I create, may I become many. The desire arises and the creation process is initiated. So as though the creative power is enlivened. We don't have too much time to discuss this, but anyway, how any creation takes. How is a musician, for example, we invite sometimes, you know, a musician is normally, while walking, is an ordinary person. When he comes here, then he starts this box music, you know, things happen inside him. And slowly his power of singing or music is invoked in him, and then he starts singing. You can't ask him to sing just like that. It's a very minute, Swami, where is the accompaniment? Where is this? Where is that? He needs all that stuff, you know, for enlivening his creative power. A sculptor is walking and he sees a rough and beautiful stone. In his mind, he sees in the stone a beautiful picture of Lord Krishna. In his mind, to us, it is only a rough and tough stone. When he sees the stone, the sculptor in him becomes awakened. Until then, he was an ordinary person. You follow? All of a sudden, letter writing. Then something happens within me. I start writing an email, start writing a letter. So the creative power is lying dormant. That power has to be awakened in order for the creation to take place. Otherwise, it doesn't take place. Even musician cannot sing. That sometimes is starting trouble. Have you seen that starting trouble? When you have bhajan program, come on, sing. Starting, he cannot sing. Nothing comes. Starting trouble. Then when something is when his singing is invoked, then the fellow starts singing. So the creative power is lying dormant. And with the enliven that creative power, then the creation takes place. Whether it's cooking or writing a letter or stitching, anything requires enlivening of our creative power. Similarly, Lord says in the beginning, he enlivens, the Maya, creative power is lying dormant, is enlivened, and then the creation process commences. So Lord Krishna says, Tasmin garbham dasamyam, my creative power, Maya, which is sleeping, lying dormant, I as though impregnate it, meaning that I bring it to, I invoke it. That's how the whole creation starts. You go on until gets the steam runs out. Again dissolution. Again creation. Again dissolution. All this process goes on. But the idea is that all there is one entity. Who is that? You call it Lord. Call it Brahman. Call it consciousness. Call it one. What is creation? That one appearing as many. Understand that. Because before creation, there was only one Ishvara. Where do you get all these fellows? One appearing as many. That one chose to put on all these countless costumes. There are 8.4 million species. That's what they say. 84 lakh. Meaning large number of species are there. That many kinds of costumes are there. Because he is a great creator. A human being cannot create 8.4 million costumes regardless of how many, but he creates. And first he creates the costume and enters the costume. He puts on all the costumes. So who are we? Same Brahman, same limitless, same consciousness, same Lord, with our individual costumes. In an ordinary play or a movie, one actor only plays one role. Or sometimes in a movie they can play double role, triple role. But here, this great actor called Nataraj, he plays countless roles simultaneously. And therefore, every individual is nothing but the manifestation of that limitless self in a limited costume. But unfortunately, he wakes up with a wrong GPS. If he remembered that I am limitless, functioning through this limited costume, no problem at all. But then, Purusha Prakritisthohi, this Purusha, the Self, becomes identified with this Prakriti, with this costume, and is born looking upon this role as his own Self. We are born with identification with this costume. This costume is made up of three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. This is the another way of explaining the universe is that the universe is created from three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. Some of you may have studied the text called Tattva Bodha where all this is explained, but briefly, this gross body is made up of tamas, our organs of action and prana made of rajas, mind and sense organs made of sattva. Now, our mind has three dispositions, sattva, rajas and tamas. Sometimes we feel very happy, very cheerful for no reason at all. Sometimes for no reason you find yourself happy. You wake up happy. Or a small thing makes you happy. Just look at the sun rise and become happy. Sometimes the mind is cheerful, tranquil, contemplative. Not a very long time, but there are times. That is when the mind enjoys sattva. More often than not, mind is agitated, active, I'm going to do this, do that, rajas. And sometimes the mind is dull, inert, no motivation, no initiative, no activity. It is called tamas. Sattva, rajas and tamas. So now Lord Krishna wants to explain our life. We said that because of ignorance, we identify with the costume. Identify with these three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas, and have a variety of experiences, a variety of feelings about ourselves. So what they are, if you understand that, then we can understand. So this 14th chapter presents a beautiful analysis of our mind. That our mind is also made up of three dispositions, sattva, rajas and tamas. There is nothing wrong with that. Problem is that we identify with it. It's one thing to watch a movie and enjoy it. It's another thing to become identified with that and feel, you know, then you become a different person. So also, we identify with these three gunas and what experiences happen so that we can understand our own disposition and we'll know how to deal with it. For that, Lord Krishna now explains these three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. So let us take up the verse number 3.
Sattvam rajastama iti gunah prakriti samvaha nibadnanti mahabaho dehe dehinam avyayam.
See the second line, nimadnanti mahabaho dehe dehinam avyayam. Dehe avyayam dehinam nimadnanti. See the translation. Third line, dehe to the body, avyayam the changeless, dehinam the indwell of the body, nimadnanti mind.
mind is changeless, indwells the body to the body. So they create identification. Who is the actor? So you can see two words here, dehi and deha. Deha means what? Body. Dehi means the indweller of the body. Griha and gruhi. Griha means a house. Gruhi means an indweller of the house. Deha, the house. Dehi, the indweller of the body. If the body is looked upon as a dwelling place, then dehi is the indweller of the body. So simply by using these two words, it is made clear to us that there are two entities here. One is the dwelling, other is the indweller. Within a personality is made up of these two, dwelling and the indweller. This deha, the body, is like a dwelling place in which the indweller, the self, the consciousness dwells. That is fine. Or the costume is a dwelling place and the actor dwells in the costume. But the problem is nibadnanti. Because of GPS we are born with. We are born with the habit of identifying with this dwelling place. So indweller identifies the dwelling, the actor identifies with the costume and takes himself to be as big or small as a costume. Meaning that the indweller, who is limitless, habitually identifies himself with his body which is limited and looks upon himself as a limited entity. Just as an actor, who is a wealthy person, identifies with his costume of beggar and takes himself to be a beggar. Similarly, the limitless dehi, so avyayam, changeless, limitless, dehi, the indweller, the self, habitually identifies with deha, the body, the costume. As a result, he entertains the complex that I am the body. Just as the actor says, I am the beggar. And so also, his dehi says, I am the deha. I am the body. The body has a birth. So I was born. Body will have a death. I will die. Meaning that all the limitations of the body are automatically thought to be the limitations of the self. Limitation is not a problem. Birth is not the problem. Death is also not a problem. You know what is the problem? That there was birth is not a problem. What's the problem, you know? I was born. The birth is not the problem. I was born. That's the problem. The I is joined with birth. That's the problem. Death also is not a problem. I will die or I am dying. Once I is joined, everything becomes a problem. Failure is not a problem. You did something and that endeavor did not succeed, okay. Even failure is not a problem. What's the problem? I failed. So all that we need to do is to create a distance. When two things are lumped into one, the problem, two things are appreciated as two, solution. So Lord Krishna says that when you perform an action, there will be an outcome called success or failure. Let it be. But you know what we do? I succeeded. I failed, I succeeded, problem. No, Swami, that's not a problem. Because if I succeed, I will fail also. If it is my nature to identify the outcome, If outcome is success and I call I am successful, if the outcome is I will call I am failure.
Doesn't matter, Swamiji. It is I enjoy, I am successful. But you don't enjoy, unfortunately. The success also cannot enjoy too long. You know the problem with this, what are these cavaliers? Problem will be that next year they'll be under pressure to win. Next year also. Is that not so? That's the problem. That you are under pressure now, that you won last time, so people expect you. And you also expect us, so tremendous. No sooner the celebration of the victory is over, immediately the pressure of how to win next time now will come, has to come. That's the mind. Look at our own self. I never scored first rank. Moment I scored first rank in one, you know, in 9th standard, immediate pressure. Next year also. If next year I score second rank, I'm as good as a failure. Second rank. Meaning that success also creates the pressure of remaining successful. Now that is called stress. That is unhappy. That is dukkham. If I can take the success as it is and enjoy it and forget about it, but no, when I brand myself successful, then there is a need of remaining successful. If success and I are separate, then there is no problem. So understand that I am a failure is a direct cause of unhappiness, and that I am successful is a potential cause of unhappiness. Every identification is a cause of unhappiness. Because even if I am successful, I cannot get over the fact that I am limited. So then they will say, okay, cavaliers won after I don't know how many years. But you know something? This Golden State fellows, Warriors won 3 times already. So now you have to better their score. This Usain Bolt, no? This fellow, the fastest sprinter in the world. You know what is his problem? Now, every race that takes place, he will watch. He may again participate in the next Olympics, For the whole of his life, he'll be under stress. You know what stress? That nobody should batter his record. That will be his need now. That not only I am the fastest now, I should be fastest forever. Now, that is what he imposed upon. But he will impose. That is human mind. That's called identification. You don't need anybody else to create stress in you. You are enough. That is GPS we are born with, understand. And people just don't understand this. You go to all workshops and all sorts of things and pay $2,000 and how to become successful. But this thing, basic thing, nobody understands this. To be successful is not my problem. I don't care for success. I care about I being successful. No, that is I'm creating problem for myself. Let success be where it is, and you are where you are. Let movie be where it is, you remain where you are. Remain a spectator. That's your true status. Don't become a character. A spectator becomes a character. That's the problem. So this is a basic problem in our life. It's called identification. Success is one thing. Identification, success, I am successful. There is identification with success. Failure is one thing. I am a failure. Identification with failure. Now this is human problem. What is the problem? Identification a problem. You know what we do? We retain the tendency of identification intact and do with success and failure and struggle for the whole life. But the basic problem of identification is retained, you know. Like that ant, you know, there were two ants who were friends of each other. Ants. One ant got married to another fellow who was in a sugar factory. Other ant got married to a place where there was this salt mine, you know. They were in correspondence with the Facebook correspondence. Some correspondence was there between them.
So this poor ant that went to the salt field, always, you know, losing weight day by day by day. The ant that went to the sugar field factory was putting on day by day. So therefore, this ant invited her friends, you come and spend some time with us, you know, and then you'll, this is a nice place, you get a lot of food here, you'll put on some weight. So this ant comes. For 15 days also, you know, no weight is put on. What's the problem with you? Take them to doctor. Doctor Ant. So then doctor took the history and what is what, and then the doctor also was puzzled. Then a bright idea came in the mind of the doctor. He says, open your mouth. She opened the mouth. You know what was found? A little piece of salt inside. Because that she brought with her. That she would not give up. And as long as you retain that piece of salt, doesn't matter what sugar you go to, so also as long as you retain this tendency of identification, doesn't matter what you do. We keep on changing the world in success and failure and this and that, retaining your basic problem. And therefore, regardless of what medicine you take, nothing will happen. You can never be successful, I can guarantee you. As long as I identified, I can never be successful. World will call me successful. You ask me, people whom we call successful, go and ask them whether they think they are successful or not. Have you for now discovered total satisfaction in life? Nobody can. As long as I measure myself by the dimension of my costume, there is no way, because however big the costume is, it is still limited. Our Swami would say, what is the difference between one and infinity? Infinity. What is the distance between 100 and infinity? Infinity. Is it not? A million and infinity? Infinity. A billion and infinity? Infinity. Meaning that billion also will feel only infinitely separated from infinity. Is it not so? Regardless of how big you become, you can never become infinite. You can never add up any numbers and multiply, you can never become infinite. You would only discover that it's infinite, that's all. We are trying to become infinite. Wrong GPS. You attend all workshops and spend thousands of dollars. But the GPS is not corrected by anybody because they don't know themselves. Wrong GPS. So first Lord Krishna says, what happens because of the wrong GPS? That our personality is made up of three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. So that we can understand how this habitual identification results into what kind of experiences. What kind of experience I have, from there I can understand what kind of mind I have and what changes I need to carry out within my mind so as to become fit for creating a distance. You see, you cannot create distance unless you evolved to a certain point, unless you made your mind pure, so that purity of mind is required even to create the distance. Otherwise, right away I can say I'm not the body. I can say that. Chidananda Rupa Shivoham, I do say that. Seeing is one thing and seeing can be a different thing. For seeing what I say, it is necessary that I should have a certain disposition of mind called sattvic mind, pure mind. For that I should understand what impurities are. Then I can get rid of those impurities, make my mind pure, create the distance with the help of the teaching and own up my true nature. As simple as that. So, Lord Krishna says that this three guna, what is guna? That word is borrowed from Sankhya people, they also use call it. This is their prakriya. The sattva rajas tamas is the prakriya or methodology employed by Sankhya, which also Vedanta uses. Vedanta uses all the development of all other schools of thought. Every school of thought has made great contributions to the thinking, to the storehouse of knowledge. So Lord Krishna says, Sattvam Rajah Tamah Gunah Prakriti Sambhavah. These three are called guna. But guna means said quality or disposition. Guna here means a technical word, disposition in this case. The word guna also, then the meaning is, guna also means a rope, by the way. And sattva, rajas, tamas, these three are the strands from which the rope is made, which binds. How a calf is bound to a post? A calf, a little animal, bound to a post with a rope. Similarly, as though this poor Atma is bound to the Anatma with these ropes of these three, sattva, rajas, tamas. Like, this is like an allegory, I mean, you know. Now, you don't imagine that there is a calf in, but just as a calf is tied to a post with the help of a rope, so also as though this Dehi, the Atma, the Self, the Limitless, is tied to this post of this limited body by the rope made up of the three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. The Lord Krishna proceeds now. So this is how the gunas bind. Really, nobody binds us other than ignorance. Although literally it says the gunas bind you. Lord Krishna, the three gunas bind the Atma with the body. Really, it is not right. What binds? Ignorance binds. Ignorance automatically results into identification. It's identification that binds. The costume of beggar also does not bind. The actor also does not bind. Identification of the actor with the costume binds. When does that identification happen? When the actor momentarily forgets his identity, then the identification with the costume takes place. Identification presupposes ignorance. Without ignorance, identification cannot be. When I am watching movie, when I momentarily forget my true identity, identify with what I am not, identification presupposes ignorance. We are born with ignorance. And we are born with the tendency to identify with what we are not. What is the most proximate thing? This body, mind, sense complex is the most proximate thing. And therefore, we are born with a habit of identifying with the body, mind, sense complex. And that identification now, is in three stages: sattvic identification, rajasic identification, tamasic identification. Depending upon the quality of identification, your feelings also will change. How will you feel? So now Lord Krishna presents a very beautiful analysis of how we feel when we identify with the different dispositions of mind. Let us read the next verse here. Tatra sattvam nirmalatvad prakashakamanamayam sukhasangena badnati jnana sangena chanagha. Tatra means what? There, sattvam nirmalatvat. Now that we mention the three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas, of them, one by one, Lord Krishna says, we will explain to you. begin with sattva. Tatra of the three, what is the nature of sattvam? Tatra sattvam nirmalattat. This sattva is nirmalam. Mala means impurity. Nirmala means free from impurity. Means not pure. Tatra sattvam nirmalattat. Because sattva is pure. Three qualities are given here. Prakashakam. You know, prakasha means light. Prakashaka, that is, gives light, that is, illumines. So, sattva has the quality of illumination. Sattva is pure by nature. To illumine is its nature. Anamayam. Anamayam. You know, we chant this prayer. Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha. Sarve santu niramayaha. With niramaya, nis plus anaya becomes niramaya. Call it niramaya or anamaya, same thing. Amaya means affliction. Sarve santu niramayaha. May all be healthy, free from all disease, free from all afflictions. So niramaya, free from affliction, disease, sorrow, pain. So sattva is this beautiful quality. We'll talk about it tomorrow further. But sattva has three qualities. It is pure by nature, it is illuminating, and it is free from all affliction, free from all sorrow. Meaning that when the mind becomes sattvic, becomes free from all afflictions, all sorrow, all unhappiness, becomes what? Prakashakam. It illumines. Illumines what? The happiness which is our nature. Therefore, you are cheerful. You are happy for no reason. So, there is happiness because of reason. There is happiness without reason. When the mind is sattvic, it is happy without reason. When the mind is rajasic, it is happy because of reason. So when mind is rajasic, it wants to eat this, it wants to see this, it wants this entertainment. And then when that happens, it is happy. So your desire is fulfilled, you are happy. So all rajasic happiness comes from outside because of a reason. All sattvic happiness comes from within us without a reason. When happiness is with reason, we are happy as long as that reason is. The happiness goes away when the reason also goes away, right? When happiness comes without a reason, since there is no reason, so it cannot go away, therefore that happiness also but will not go away. So if we are sure that we want happiness that does not go away, happiness that comes with reason is happiness that comes with dependence. Because I am dependent upon that reason for my happiness, because good food came, good movie is there, because something, whatever, some desirable, pleasurable object is there, and therefore I am happy. Meaning that in that happiness, the element of dependence is automatically involved. I am dependent upon that thing for my happiness, on music, on food, on movie, on promotion, on my name, fame, etc., whatever it is that causes happiness to me, as long as it comes from something other than myself, so long I am dependent upon that, and I can be happy as long as that lasts. Sometimes even that also is not there. I get a new car which I was waiting for. My dad said that you have to score, 2,300 points in SAT, then I'll get you a sports car. 2,350 score. I'm waiting for 18th birthday. And my favorite sports car is given to me. I'm in heaven. I'm not on this road. excitement. First day, second day, third day, 15 day, 1 month, 3 months, how long? Then becomes a routine, isn't it?
Because everything has a diminishing utility, and therefore it stops giving. First day the excitement that comes, second day there is excitement, little less, little less, little less. After 3 months there may not be any excitement at all. I pray for him that there will be, but generally speaking, that's how things are. So in the rajasic happiness, not only there's dependence, but the thing which gives me happiness slowly loses its utility, and therefore its effectiveness, and therefore I find myself needing something else or needing more. Meaning my neediness, my craving never is satisfied. I'm always dependent. And that happiness is a binding happiness. What we want is sattvic happiness that comes without a reason. So therefore, how we should transform our mind from tamas to rajas, rajas to sattva, and then transcend the sattva. Create the distance. When can you create distance? When the mind is sattvic in the first place. With tamas or rajas, there will be more words than reality. With sattva, these words also become reality. Therefore, we must understand our mind well. And these verses are giving us a very beautiful understanding of our own mind or disposition, so that we can become our own therapist. We can become, in fact, intelligent, informed therapist, and decide, because Bhagavad Gita gives us also the method how to change from tamas to rajas, from rajas to sattva, and to transcend sattva. All these things is given in the Gita. That is why it is a great manual, the real GPS. That's why I call it the Gita positioning system. That's a true GPS, you know. It gives us from the wrong GPS to the true GPS. So we'll see tomorrow the discussion on these gunas. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.